Welcome to this first video about the best strategies to convert alkenes into epoxides. In this first presentation, we'll have a look at the mechanism of the reaction and at some industrial epoxidations. I'll then show you some selective epoxidations of mostly polyfunctional compounds, including enantioselective epoxidations. Finally, we'll go through the most important side reactions. Part 2 of this playlist is about the epoxidation of allylic alcohols, and in part 3, the epoxidation of electron-deficient alkenes is discussed. One older strategy to convert alkenes into epoxides is by intermediate preparation of a chloro- or bromohydrene by treatment with halogens in water. The halohydrene can then be cyclized with bases. Epichlorohydrin is currently still produced this way. It is an important intermediate for the preparation of glycidyl ethers as monomers for epoxy resins. More environmentally friendly are epoxidations with the aid of hydroperoxides, because here no chloride waste is generated. The required hydroperoxides can be prepared from alkanes and oxygen. And the main disadvantage of this strategy is the formation of alcohols as byproducts. Still more convenient are epoxidations with hydrogen peroxide or oxygen, but not all alkenes can be epoxidized this way because of allylic oxidation or the oxidation of other functional groups. Ethylene is one of the few alkenes that can be epoxidized with oxygen with the aid of a silver catalyst. Currently, about 30 million tons of ethylene oxide are being prepared this way every year. Ethylene oxide is mainly used for preparing ethylene glycol, dioxane, polyethylene glycol, and, by treatment with ammonia, ethanol amines and morpholine. Another epoxide prepared on a huge scale is propylene oxide. Here, the direct oxidation with oxygen does not work well, causing mostly allylic oxidation. Older processes for preparing propylene oxide from propene include the catalyzed oxidation with hydroperoxides. The problem with this approach is the formation of stoichiometric amounts of alcohols as byproduct. More convenient is the HPPO process, an epoxidation with hydrogen peroxide catalyzed by a zeolite. Direct epoxidation with oxygen would be still less expensive and is intensely being investigated. For smaller scale epoxidations, a number of selective oxidants are available. Depending on the type of starting alkene, epoxidations can be conducted under acidic, neutral, or alkaline conditions. Acid-resistant alkenes are usually oxidized with peroxy acids, for instance metachloroperbenzoic acid, peracetic acid, or magnesium peroxy phthalate. Mixtures of hydrogen peroxide and formic acid can often also be used. Commercial aqueous solutions of hydrogen peroxide are stabilized with phosphoric acid and therefore slightly acidic. In combination with some acidic catalyst, these solutions can bring about the epoxidation of many alkenes. Such catalysts include zeolites, tungstic acid, and methyl trioxyrrhenium. Even ketones can activate hydrogen peroxide. The more electrophilic the ketone, the stronger the activation. With chiral, enantiomerically pure ketones, enantioselective epoxidations can be achieved. From acetone and hydrogen peroxide, however, highly crystalline acetone peroxide is readily formed, which is a dangerous explosive. In one company I worked for, an accident occurred because acetone and hydrogen peroxide had condensed in a pump. Upon turning it on, the pump started burning and injured a worker and caused a serious fire. Acid-sensitive olefins can be epoxidized with hydroperoxides and a catalyst under almost neutral conditions. Recently, epoxidations with oxygen and a ruthenium catalyst have been reported. Dimethyl dioxyrrhene also enables epoxidations under almost neutral conditions. This volatile reagent is prepared from oxone and acetone and is usually used as a solution in acetone. Nitriles react with hydrogen peroxide under basic conditions, and the resulting intermediate is a powerful epoxidizing reagent, both for electron-rich and electron-deficient alkenes. The latter can usually be converted into epoxides selectively by treatment of hydrogen peroxide and a weak base, with sodium perborate or with bleach. These reactions are discussed in part 3 of this video playlist. The mechanism of alkene epoxidation depends on the precise structure of the alkene and the oxidant. Simple alkenes react with peroxy acids by concerted stereospecific 2 plus 1 cycloaddition, similar to the addition of carbenes to olefins. If the alkene readily forms a carbocation, however, as in the case of enamines or enol ethers, or when the oxidant is a strong electrophile, a two-step mechanism with ionic intermediates may be considered. For most unsymmetric alkenes, the true mechanism of epoxidation will be located somewhere between these two extremes. Polar solvents may also tilt the true mechanism more in the direction of an ionic epoxidation. Unlike catalytic hydrogenations, the rate of epoxidation with peroxy acids depends mainly on the ionization potential of an alkene and not on sterical accessibility. Additional alkyl substituents strongly enhance the epoxidation rate, as shown here for epoxidations with peracetic acid. Such epoxidations are usually acid catalyzed because acids enhance the electrophilicity of the peroxy acid. Protic solvents, on the other hand, mostly slow such reactions down, and epoxidations with peroxy acids are therefore often conducted in chloroform or dichloromethane. Let's have a look at some specific examples. First, I've chosen some representative monoepoxidations of dienes. In this example, the birch reduction product of orthoxylene was oxidized with a slight excess of MCPBA. The more electron-rich tetra-substituted alkene could be epoxidized with high selectivity. Catalytic hydrogenation would have occurred at the less substituted double bond. Here, the starting diene contained two tri-substituted double bonds, one of them being slightly deactivated by two acetoxy groups. Again, a highly selective monoepoxidation succeeded, this time with peracetic acid as oxidant. This here is an enantioselective epoxidation of a diene similar to the previous one. Here, one C-C double bond was slightly deactivated by an arene, but this was again sufficient to provide an acceptable yield of monoepoxide. The oxidant was a mixture of hydrogen peroxide with an enantiomerically pure ketone. If in a given diene one alkene is substituted with an electron withdrawing group, as in this example, selective monoepoxidations are usually easy. The electron-rich alkene can be selectively oxidized with a peroxy acid or hydrogen peroxide under acidic conditions, while the electron-deficient alkene will react more quickly under alkaline conditions. Here, the more electron-rich alkene was epoxidized enantioselectively with hydrogen peroxide and a chiral manganese complex, the so-called Jacobson catalyst. Also, tungstic acid derivatives catalyzed the epoxidation of simple alkenes with hydrogen peroxide, as in this example. Again, the electron-deficient C-C double bond was not oxidized, and even the formyl group remained unchanged. Also, myrcene can be selectively epoxidized with hydrogen peroxide and tungstate without any additional solvent. Although 1,3 dienes are usually more reactive than unconjugated alkenes, epoxidation is often slower. Formic acid can also be used as catalyst for selective epoxidations with hydrogen peroxide. Excessive heating should be avoided, because this can cause a ring opening of the epoxide and formation of formates or diols. Despite the excess of hydrogen peroxide, only the tri-substituted alkene was oxidized in this case. Here, a diene was epoxidized twice with a large excess of hydrogen peroxide and manganese sulfate and salicylic acid as catalysts. The reaction was conducted in acetonitrile under slightly alkaline conditions and probably proceeded by intermediate activation of hydrogen peroxide by addition to acetonitrile. A high yield of diepoxide was attained in this instance. When 3-carene was treated with the same reagents and catalysts, however, allylic oxidation occurred to a large extent. Transition metals can sometimes promote such allylic oxidations. With peroxy acids or with tungstate and hydrogen peroxide, carene can be cleanly epoxidized in high yield without any allylic oxidation. Here are two examples of optimized selective monoepoxidations of a diene with hydrogen peroxide. In the upper reaction, one equivalent of formic acid was used as activator, while in the second example, 10% of hexachloroacetone was used. Both reactions proceeded under mild, almost neutral conditions. This is another example of epoxidation with hydrogen peroxide and acetonitrile. To prevent twofold epoxidation, the reaction was stopped before complete conversion of the starting diene. Despite the huge excess of oxidant, only two diastereomeric monoepoxides were obtained. Here, the trisubstituted alkene was deactivated by an oxazole and an acyloxy group, and the disubstituted alkene was oxidized preferentially. Haloalkenes, enol ethers and enamines can also be converted into epoxides, but these are more reactive than epoxides devoid of heteroatom substituents and can be difficult to isolate. Here, a halogenated hexene was oxidized with MCPBA and a high yield of crude epoxide resulted after 4 days. Most of this product isomerized, however, into a ketone upon contact with silica gel. This is an example of a rather difficult epoxidation of a brominated alkene. None of the common oxidants gave substantial yields of the required epoxide. Only with oxone activated by a benzophenone could fair yields of the epoxide be attained. As already mentioned, heteroatom-substituted epoxides are quite unstable and readily isomerize or hydrolyze to ketones, as shown here. Therefore, these products are mainly used for the preparation of hydroxyketones from ketones via intermediate enol ethers. Here, an enol ether was epoxidized by treatment with an excess of dimethyl dioxyrane at minus 20 degrees Celsius. Alkynes are usually resistant to epoxidation because the resulting oxyrenes would be anti-aromatic and thus very energetic and unstable. This is an example of an enantioselective epoxidation of an enol benzoate with hydrogen peroxide and a chiral ketone. Both the yield and enantioselectivity were good. Here, a highly reactive amino-substituted epoxide was prepared from a pyroline. It is really surprising that the authors were able to isolate this product and purify it by chromatography. The bicyclic structure may prevent a suitable alignment of the lone pair at nitrogen with the antibonding carbon-oxygen bond orbital and thus cause this amazing stability. Imides are much less carbocation stabilizing than unprotected amines, and the epoxides prepared from N-alkanil imides therefore more stable than epoxides as the one of the previous example. Here, an N-alkanil succinimide was epoxidized enantioselectively with oxone and a chiral ketone. Unprotected amines also react with most epoxidizing reagents, and alkenes containing amino groups can usually only be converted into epoxides in the presence of acids. Ammonium salts are less nucleophilic and more difficult to oxidize than free amines. In this example, a substituted glycine could, however, be epoxidized with MCPBA under almost neutral conditions, without extensive oxidation of the amino group. Alpha amino acid derivatives are less basic and more resistant toward oxidation than simple alkyl amines. What may be the reason why this reaction worked? In this example, however, the oxidation by MCPBA of an aniline to a nitrone proceeded faster than oxidation of the alkene. This oxidation could be suppressed by mesylate formation, probably because the unprotected phenolic hydroxy group stabilized the nitrone and thereby facilitated its formation. Moreover, 2 and 4 hydroxy anilines are particularly easy to oxidize to quinone imines. So, what other side reactions do we have to reckon with? Some epoxides are unstable, in particular those with halogen, amino or alkoxy substituents. Such epoxides may decompose into ketones, aldehydes or allylic alcohols already during the reaction or attempted isolation. If allylic alcohols are formed during the epoxidation, these may be oxidized again and yield enones, as in the example shown here. This here is another example of allylic oxidation during an attempted epoxidation with MCPBA. With just one equivalent of oxidant, an allylic alcohol was formed in high yield. Additional oxidant then yielded an enone. The main reason for this reactivity was stabilization of the tertiary carbocation by an alkoxy pyrosol. Despite the low reaction temperature and apolar solvent, the intermediate epoxides were not sufficiently stable and underwent ring cleavage and isomerization, as shown here. Another potential side reaction is the oxidative hydroxylation of tertiary CH groups, as in this example. Many of the typical epoxidizing reagents can bring about such hydroxylations, sometimes under surprisingly mild conditions. Traces of transition metals often catalyze these oxidations, but, as shown here, are not strictly required. Highly enolized ketones or carboxylic acid derivatives can also be alpha hydroxylated by intermediate formation of a hydroxy epoxide. In this example, this hydroxylation was faster than the epoxidation of an allyl group. Upon treatment with peroxy acids, ketones can be converted into carboxylic esters. The Bayer-Willinger reaction can sometimes be catalyzed by Brønsted or Lewis acids, and neutral or mildly alkaline conditions may help to suppress this side reaction. The poor result in the example shown here was probably also caused by the excessively long reaction time. Aldehydes are readily oxidized to carboxylic acids and may also undergo oxidative decarbonylation during epoxidations, as in this example. The lactone was probably formed by alpha hydroxylation of the formyl group, followed by twofold Bayer-Willinger oxidation. Occasionally, alkenes are cleaved during epoxidations, in particular in the presence of transition metals, such as iron, cobalt, copper, or manganese. In this example, a small amount of benzaldehyde was formed during epoxidation of stilbene, but carboxylic acids are the more common byproducts. In this example, oxidation with hydrogen peroxide and tungstate as catalyst yielded only little epoxide, but mainly an aldehyde and a carboxylic acid, depending on the reaction time. Thus, to prevent isomerization, hydrolysis, or oxidative degradation of an epoxide, only a slight excess of oxidant should be used, the reaction time should be kept short, and the reaction temperature should be as low as possible. Some alkanes are easy to dehydrogenate, in particular if conjugated polyenes or aromatics are thereby formed. Such compounds can be difficult to epoxidize in high yield, because dehydrogenation is likely to compete with epoxidation. In this example, almost one-third of the starting alkene underwent aromatization instead of the expected epoxidation. Arenes are not usually epoxidized by the typical epoxidation reagents, and only occasionally is this side reaction observed. Polycyclic arenes are particularly reactive, and in this example, acridine was epoxidized successfully at room temperature with hydrogen peroxide and a manganese catalyst. On this and the next slide, there are some more examples, mostly of the epoxidation of polyfunctional starting alkenes. You can also find these references in the description of this video. Part 2 of this playlist is about the epoxidation of allylic alcohols and related compounds. Although even unfunctionalized alkenes can be epoxidized with high enantio and diastereoselectivity, as shown in some of the examples above, the stereoselective epoxidation of allylic alcohols is usually much easier. See you then!